Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. If I could get everyone to take your seats, we will get started this evening with what we hope is a wonderful evening in the history of the University of Houston. My name is Mike Padé. I'm the Associate Vice President for Alumni Relations at the University of Houston, and most importantly, a 1989 University of Houston graduate from the Hilton College of Hotel Restaurant Management. Works every time. And your MC for the evening. Welcome to the 60th Annual UHAA Alumni Awards Gala. To get our proceedings started this evening, I ask that you join me in welcoming the ladies and gentlemen that we are so proud to honor here this evening. Each of our honorees tonight will be escorted by one of the fine members of the UHAA Board of Directors, who so ably represent all UH alumni during the year and help make events like tonight possible. So without any further ado, please welcome one of our outstanding volunteers for 2014, Amanda Heath. Amanda is escorted by UHAA Board of Directors and immediate past chair John Clark and UHAA board member Trey Wilkinson. Please welcome another one of our outstanding volunteers for 2014, Sharon Spillman, escorted by UHAA board members Joe Pogge and Rusty Ruska. Please welcome one of our distinguished service honorees this evening, Lance Livingston. Lance is being escorted by UHAA board member Patty Godfrey. Please welcome the other one of our distinguished service honorees this evening, Rick Noriega. Colonel Noriega is being escorted by UHAA board member Fermin Fazal. And now for our Distinguished Alumni Award honorees for 2014. Please join me in welcoming Distinguished Alumni Award honoree Philip Zillikow. Philip is being escorted by board member Kathy Frank. Please welcome Alumni Award honoree Rafael Ortega. Rafael is escorted tonight by UHAA board member Durg Kumar. Please welcome our next distinguished alumni honoree, Andre Ware. Andre is being escorted by UHAA board chair Starlet Agrella. And join me now in welcoming our final distinguished alumni award honoree tonight, Doug Brooks. Doug is being escorted tonight by UHAA past chair Judy Lilly. This will be our only opportunity to get a group photo of our honorees. So while we do that, how about a round of applause for our great looking group tonight, our 2014 induction class. You can all take your seats and we'll get started. Another round of applause for our honorees tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, it takes a great group of alumni to make UHAA run so smoothly and to make tonight's event run so smoothly as well. Let me bring to the podium to welcome you to tonight's event the chair of the University of Houston Alumni Association Board of Directors, Starlet Agrella.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Starlet Agrella, and I'm the chair of the Board of Directors of the Alumni Association. I welcome you all for being here. You know, tonight is a night where we really step back and we honor all of the U of H alumni. Particularly, we're here to honor some very worthy honorees. Recognizing what this evening is all about, it's really dedicated to each one of us, friends of the University of Houston, as well as the honorees who really have given U of H a spot on the map. As we all know, the challenges faced by universities all over the world require dedication and support for alumni and friends. It's really an essential element for growth and sustainability. All of our honorees tonight are shining examples of what it means to give back. Each time a former student returns to campus to participate in an event, to raise funds, or to volunteer their time, they leave an incredible mark on the university. I congratulate all of tonight's honorees, and I thank them for all that they have done to make the University of Houston a place we are all proud to be. The University of Houston Alumni Association hosts over 120 events each year. We have over 100,000 employees and students who work in this Houston area. There's another 100,000 outside of the city. The University of Houston has 35 constituent organizations. They operate under the U of H Alumni Association umbrella. Each of these students' organizations have raised money to give scholarships to deserving students. Last year, we raised over $200,000 for deserving students. Tonight's event will help raise significant funds to continue this important endeavor. I want to thank all of the constituent groups, as well as our wonderful alumni staff and our board of directors who helped make this happen. As I mentioned in the welcome letter in our program tonight, we are transforming the way the Alumni Association works with the university. We've been working together over the past year, and we're in the first 9 months of this collaborative effort. The goals of the Alumni Association are to increase the number of engaged alumni. We have thousands across the nation. Together, working together, we can make the University of Houston a better place. We also want to max what we give back to the alumni. By spending time together with the university, we can keep our Tier 1 status. This transformation is well underway, and I'd like to thank the Alumni Association Board of Directors who've really worked with the university to make this happen. I'm proud of what the Alumni Association has accomplished and appreciative of the time and commitment of each one of our board members. I'd like to take a moment to recognize the board that's with us tonight. If you would each stand up. I'd also like to recognize the staff of the Alumni Association. Their countless hours, as well as their passion for the university, make the association a great place to be a part of. Would you please stand up? Now I would like to recognize our incoming chair for next year, who was the underwriter chairman for this event tonight, Joe Poggi.
First of all, congratulations to our nominees. You're an inspiration, true inspiration. You show us passion and vision. And to this room, this is the foundation of the Alumni Association. And I challenge all of you tonight to go out, look at your Rolodex, and get those cougs that haven't come out of the closet and get them participating, because the stronger we have our Alumni Association, the stronger our school is, and we are Cougar Pride.
Lastly, let me just highlight a few accomplishments that the university has made this past year. Annual giving is up over $110 million. That's record-setting, all-time record for the University of Houston. Ground baking has commenced, and our football stadium is about to be in place for this season. I know we're all proud to go to a football game at the new stadium. We've also been named one of the best colleges in the Princeton Review and the U.S. News and World Report. Measures have put U of H on the map among the 50 top public universities in endowment assets, annual giving, National Academy members, faculty awards, doctorates, and last but not least, the induction of Guy V. Lewis into the Naismith Memorial Basketball Hall of Fame. Congratulations to everyone in the U of H family of what we have been able to accomplish this year. I know I'm proud to be a Cougar, and I'm proud to be with you as an alumni. Now is my time to introduce the chairman of the University of Houston Board of Regents, the Honorable Jarvis Hollinsworth.
Thank you, Starlet, and good evening to everyone. You know, in the course of the year, as chairman of the board of Regents of the University of Houston, I get to speak to a lot of different groups and involve myself in a lot of events. But no event is more important than this one. Because here tonight is where we get to recognize our fellow alumni, those who have done great things for this university and are doing great things in the community. It's also special because this is the 60th anniversary of the U of H Alumni Association. It's been 60 great years. So tonight, we pause for a moment to say thank you and celebrate our new class, who you just saw, of distinguished alumni and the recipients of our service and volunteer awards. On behalf of the board, to each of you honorees, it's my privilege to congratulate each of you for the passion and the commitment that you have for this university. You set the stage and the standard for all of us. I'd also like to thank Mike Paday, Starla Grella, and the U of H Alumni Board Directors who you saw stand for their vision and, of course, for their support. Just a few facts I want to give you about the university. I know everybody knows that we've been on a meteoric rise the last several years. Thanks a lot to our wonderful Chancellor, Renu Couture, who couldn't be here with us this evening. But the U of H system now enrolls more than 66,000 students. We award more than 14,500 degrees annually. And we produce more than $125 million in annual research. Quite simply, contrary to what other universities may tell you, the UH system does more to enroll and graduate students and produce cutting-edge research than any other university, and I'll say that again, any other university in the region. The university does this while also remaining a national model for diversity. And also, the university is a true reflection of the region that we serve. In just a few days, I'll have the honor to participate in nine commencement exercises. We will award almost 5,000 bachelor's, master's, doctoral, and professional degrees. If you add the 4,000 that we gave in December, that means 8,000 new alumni from the University of Houston will join the workforce. Once we know most of them remain in the city of Houston, it's easy to see why the University of Houston is the engine that powers Houston's success. We are Houston's university. We're all Cougars, and this is our university. We're proud of this university. You've already had one challenge tonight. I want to give another one. It's very similar. You in this room are considered some of the biggest supporters of the University of Houston. Time, talent, treasures. Some of you give time, some of you give your talent, some give your treasures. Many of you in this room give some of all three. And for that, we say thank you to you. But even though we at the University of Houston have so much to be proud of, we still have so much to do. So, please continue to volunteer your time and your resources. Talk more about your alma mater in your business circles and in your social circles. Recruit those classmates or those alumni that you know are not involved. Wear Cougar Red on Fridays. The University of Houston will continue to do great things because of each of you. Again, thank you for all you do for U of H. True, we will ever be. Enjoy the rest of your evening and go Cougs.
Thank you very much, Jarvis. Appreciate it.
Ladies and gentlemen, thanks so much for attending tonight's events. And in just a few moments, dinner will be served. But before that happens, I want to remind you that the auction will remain open until 8:30 this evening. And I know there are over 40 fantastic items out there, including two sets of chairs from the Astrodome. Who sat in the orange level of the Astrodome back in the day? If you sat in the rainbow seats, well, that was a long way from the field. Let's be honest, we need to raise the level of our scholarships that UHAA is giving out. And we are giving out over $200,000 a year. And we need you to dig into your pockets to make that happen. Pick up something nice. And one final announcement on our honoree list tonight. You have probably noticed that Bill Worrell is not with us this evening. Bill is certainly a distinguished alumni material, but due to the Rockets playoff game, he is in Portland, and Bill will not be with us. So rather than give it to him in absentia, we want Bill to receive the recognition he deserves, and we will put him on the 2015 program. We look forward to having him with us next year. Thank you, and please enjoy your meal. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we have about 5 minutes left in the auction, and I will close it during the portion of my next piece of the program. We're about to get to tonight's business. Please continue enjoying your dessert, which will be served in a moment. I want to take a moment to welcome you to tonight's event. As you know, this is the 60th annual UHAA Distinguished Alumni Awards Gala, and this is the biggest event of the year for alumni of the University of Houston. As you have heard from our distinguished speakers so far, UH has come a long way in a short period of time, and so many exciting things are happening on campus. But one of the most exciting things that has taken place this past year is we have completed our year-long awaited and long-awaited merger of UHAA and the University of Houston and formed what we hope will be a vibrant, relevant, and important part of your lives in and out of the University of Houston. I want to thank everyone who served on a committee, on our board, or on the University of Houston leadership who made that transition possible. Thank you very much. Besides our honorees here tonight, there are many special people who make our campus thrive and become one of the great learning institutions in the country. And if I could have your attention for one moment, I'd like to point out just a couple of those who are here with you tonight. As you may know, we have a new emphasis on engaging our current student body in alumni relations and the importance of creating great alumni while they are current students. Last month, by putting in an estimated 2,000 man hours of work, the leadership of Frontier Fiesta, long considered the most impactful student program in the country, the group of students that are with us tonight pulled off the most successful Frontier Fiesta in history. Please join me in welcoming and thanking the members, our student members of the Frontier Fiesta organization who joined us here tonight. Please stand, our students who put on Frontier Fiesta this past year. I want to welcome a few of our elected officials here tonight while I have an opportunity. We are blessed to have them in attendance. City Councilwoman Melissa Noriega is here. Representative Ed Thompson is here, correct? There's Ed right there, thank you, sir. And our wonderful State Senator John Whitmire is here. As you may have noticed, student leadership is also a big deal at U of H these days. Pay attention to these three notes. The approval of an unprecedented bill to support student life on campus, housing over 8,000 students on the University of Houston campus. The approval of a bill to help fund our new stadium. And heck, this group even managed to get Cullen Boulevard repaved. And if you can do that, you should get a standing ovation. But at least at this point, help me welcome former two-term SGA President Cedric Bandow and VP Ronnie Ramchandani, who are seated right over here, and current SGA President Charles Haston, who is with us here tonight as well. Where is Charles? He is here somewhere. There he is. There he is, walking in from the auction. Well done, Charles. I also want to welcome at my table tonight seated right next to my spectacularly beautiful and supportive wife, Melanie, and my wonderful daughter, Krista, is one of the greatest quarterbacks in the history of college football, and even more importantly, a wonderful example of success after football. Recently inducted into the Southwest Conference Hall of Fame, please help me welcome David Klingler and his wife, Katie, right here. We are blessed at U of H to have a great lineup of deans and administrators, but I want our deans to stand up and take a bow. They do such a great job, so please help us welcome all of our deans here tonight. And finally, the staff at U of H has taken our university to the next level. I work with them every day on various issues, and they work so hard to make UH a great place. The best thing I can say about them is that even though many of them, the University of Houston is not their alma mater, they treat it like it is every single day. Can all the members of the President's Cabinet, Development Officers, and UHAA staff please rise and accept our appreciation? All of the staff of the University of Houston, please join us. Another group that has shown incredible leadership to UHAA, to the goals of the UH, is the board of the UH Alumni Association, led by Chair Starla DeGrella, who you heard from earlier, and by past Chair John Clark, who did such a great job of leading the transition. This group of dedicated alums gives their time, energy, and treasure to make UHAA and your university a better place. If I could please ask all the members of our board to please rise and accept our appreciation. And lastly, but certainly not least, the lifeblood of any and every institution is its alumni. They are the only constant, the only rock, the only keepers of the legacy. And you are here tonight. I would like to ask all of you in the room who are life members of the Alumni Association to please stand and accept our thanks for your dedication on behalf of our alma mater. Life members, please stand. That is one enthusiastic group. So the ladies in the hall are going to shut down the auction in 2 minutes, and I will let them shut it down when they are through. But to wrap up my comments tonight, and our program continues in just a few moments, I ask you to join me in a tradition we started a few years back. We take a moment to remember the great alumni who have come before us, blazed the trail, and led the way. Many behind the scenes, some out front, but all equally important in making the University of Houston the University for Houston.
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, I traveled each and every highway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Regrets I've had a few, but then again too few to mention. I did what I had to do, saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times I'm sure you knew when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was dark, my fill, my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way. Oh no, not me. I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say.
Hello everyone, I'm Renu Couture, President of the University of Houston. Welcome to the 60th Alumni Association's Award Gala. So alumni are so important to us. Your stories are the ones that I go and tell. You are successful, and your success gives us reason to even dream bigger. Thank you so much for your generosity with your time, with your effort, and of course, with your giving. University of Houston is so much better because you are engaged with us. When you come and be part of us, it is a vote of confidence in the direction of the university, in the future that you and I and all of us dream together. And we can accomplish so much more. I know people say all the time that University of Houston has done so well. Well, I just keep telling them that all we have done is really scratch the surface of our potential. Our best days are ahead, and I know that you and I can do a lot of things together here. So I am so sorry that I'm missing the gala, but I'm glad you are here because there is so much to celebrate about the university. Thank you for being with us. I want to congratulate all of the award winners. I hope you are excited about our baseball doing so well. Our golf did very well as well. Tennis is doing good. I think many, many sports are going well. Football is just around the corner. I just cannot wait for August 29th when the stadium will open. Please make sure that you are here. But even prior to that, please come and see the campus. It's a truly transformed campus. And it will be exciting basketball season again as our new coach, Kelvin Sampson, builds up his team. So thank you again for your support. Have fun, enjoy the evening, and go Cougs.
Thank you. Thank you, President Couture. Before we get on to our next part, we were going to do this a moment ago, but Provost Short is here. Provost, you'll be awfully proud of these students right here. I'm about to make an announcement. That fanfare you just heard is entitled Coug Call, and it was composed specifically for the 60th annual UHAA Gala by Justin Langham. Where's Justin? Justin composed that. It was a graduate student at the UH School of Music. Joining Justin tonight are doctoral students Kevin Shannon and undergrads Matthew Johnson, Alex Heiserman, and Salvador Velasco. A round of applause for this group right here, please. Thank you, gentlemen, so much. That's what makes this a great university. Well, and that was a great treat from President Couture, who, as you heard, wants to pass along congratulations to all of our honorees tonight as we get started. Okay, folks, what do you say we get this party started right now? As you know, every university needs a talented and passionate group of volunteers to get the job done. The hours are long, the pay is no good, but they love to pour into what makes us all proud. We have several past outstanding volunteer honorees with us here tonight in this category. I would like to ask Cynthia Oliver Coleman, Patty Godfrey, and Yen Yi Ma to please rise and stand to be recognized as past honorees in this category. And now, to get our party started tonight, let me introduce to you one of our outstanding volunteers for 2014 who will be joining a long list of outstanding Cougars who have given their time, energy to the University of Houston.
In sixth grade, there was college day at school, and everyone was A&M, UT, and I said, it doesn't sound really fun, and I don't want to be like everyone else anyway, so I told my mom I needed a U of H shirt. I was the only one wearing it, and I was very proud of it. Little did I know, it was probably a little bit of foreshadowing, but I was happy to have it and happy I still own it. I was going to go to U of H for a year or a semester maybe and transition out. Within the first month of being there, I just fell in love with it, didn't want to leave. Now they can't get rid of me. The ID program specifically, I mean, it's why I have the job I have today. I work for Stewart & Stevenson. It's an oil and gas company headquartered here in Houston. They were searching for people with that degree. It was traditionally more of a Texas A&M degree. U of H had it, and that's how they found me. And 11 years later, I'm still working there. My first boss there in purchasing used to call me the mistake that made it through because they thought I was an A&M grad, and I quickly explained that they got the better end of the deal with the U of H grad. I didn't actually start volunteering right away, which was the interesting thing. I moved to Dallas, kind of got involved with the alumni because I just wanted to know some people in Dallas that would go to a football game with me or would go to a University of Houston event if they were up in town. And so I called the alumni organization and said, hey, can you put me in touch with some people? And as a result of that, I met Tanya Jones when Dr. Couture actually had just been hired. When I found out I was moving back to Houston, Tanya said, you're going to get involved in this group and that group, and we're never going to let you sleep because you're going to do all this stuff. And I said, sure, sounds good. I just felt that here's a university that's done so much for me, and anything I can do to give back to it, I think is just really, really important. I was really proud when I found out. I felt like there's been so many great people before me that have gotten this award, and I don't do this because I'm going to get some kind of recognition. I do it because I love it, and I want everyone to know why I love it and why I feel so strongly about it. I'm really fortunate right now to have the time and the proximity to the university, and you know, I feel like all the elements are just there that line up to allow me to do this, and I think it's become kind of obvious that if you ask me to help, I'm probably going to say yes. So anything I can do to sort of give back to that or say thank you for that is just really important to me. I feel like maybe I kind of always thought back to that shirt, and maybe I knew something in sixth grade I didn't realize at the time, but had that passion there from the beginning, and it just hadn't maybe been tapped into right away, and I'm glad it did.
Presenting Amanda Heath with her award tonight is Tanya Jones, Director of Special Events for the University of Houston. Ladies and gentlemen, a big hand for Amanda Heath.
I just want to say thank you to UHAA and the board and everyone involved in choosing me for this. I'm so honored to be standing up here and just so proud to be a part of this. Thank you to my family, my mom and my dad and my sisters and everyone here tonight, my friends that kind of put up with me, making them come with me to a lot of stuff, but they love it, so it's fine. There's so many of you guys here tonight that I love so much and I need to thank, and I don't have time and I'm sorry. But I do want to thank Tanya because she really did get me involved, and I probably would have, but I really think she got me in a lot faster and more in depth than I probably thought I would, and I loved every single second of it. I want to thank the Dallas Alumni Group where I first started, Technology Alumni, Fort Bend Alumni, H Association, CenterPoint, Bauer, Cougar Power Hour, Cougar Athletic Alliance, and Sharon Spillman, my other award winner tonight, the band alumni, Valenti School, NSM, all those groups for letting me help, letting me hang out, letting me be a part of your groups too. I love everything about this university and what I got out of it and what it did for me, and my professors that really pushed us and got us involved and really told us what it was like to get out there and be a part of that and really become involved after, so I thank them so much for that. Thanks to, I love Dr. Couture's message and everything she does for us and her passion and athletics, Cougar Pride, everyone that really just works so hard for all of us. And I don't do this because I thought I was going to get an award. I just thought it'd be a lot of fun, and I've met some incredible people, and I just thank you so much for all of it. And if you guys, I know all of you probably are involved and do things, but if you don't, just get involved. It's so worth it, and just amazing people, and you'll love every second of it. And if you want my help, just let me know. I'll probably help your group out too. So thank you so much, and go Cougs.
Thank you so much, Amanda. True story, when Amanda was called by me for that award, she asked if she could help with the gala. And I said no. So take a year off. I want to, before we get on to our, we're going to go to our next honoree in this category. Thank you, Amanda. As you know, it takes an entire community to have a great university, and our next honoree is a leader in that area, stepping up to help UH. Our second volunteer award this year goes to...
My parents always wanted us to get an education, and I think that was important. They knew that that was the avenue to success. In 1978, we left Houston and we moved to Los Angeles, California. I graduated from high school and spent 2 years of college there. And then after those 3.5 years, my parents said, no, we need to be back in Houston. We need to move back home. and I decided to attend the University of Houston. I enrolled, I was accepted. The coaches allowed me to walk on to the women's basketball team. So I wasn't able to get a full scholarship the first year, and then I ultimately earned a scholarship in my last year. When my eligibility was up, I was not able to continue going to school due to personal issues. I was sad, but I entered the workplace and I started to work. I was a child care teacher, a teacher of preschool children. My life was empty. I wasn't fulfilled. Something was missing. I had gone to college to earn a degree. And so in 1996, when Dr. Janice Hilliard told me about a program for ex-athletes to come back and complete their degree, it was a no-brainer for me. I was going. I had about 20 hours that I needed to complete, but I needed that financial assistance to help me do that. That pivotal moment opened up so many other doors for me to get my master's and for me to get my doctorate. Without that, I'm not sure where I would be today. I love the university, and I was just happy to be a part of a team. We're very close. Now we still have relationships. After 30 years, we still stay in contact with each other. My career at Collaborative for Children is a nonprofit agency that focuses on building a strong educational foundation for young children to succeed in life. Children need a voice, and I think it's important to give back to the community at large, and why not children? They're often the ones that can't speak for themselves, and so they need advocates like us to do that for them. The person that inspired me to start volunteering for the University of Houston was Lewis Ray, and he told me about the formation of an organization called UH Cougars Athletic Alliance. It's a group of former athletes, friends of the university, and alumni who are passionate about moving the efforts forward and building a strong coalition to support the university. I think it's important to give back to the University of Houston, because the University of Houston, for me, has given me so much. It's important for all alumni to come back and to give whatever they can to help make sure that the university advances.
Presenting Sharon with her volunteer award is Lewis Ray, longtime friend, and as you saw from the video, the fellow who encouraged Sharon to participate at her alma mater. Ladies and gentlemen, please join us in honoring Dr. 3 degrees from the University of Houston, Sharon Spillman.
I would like to thank Mike Paday and the Alumni Association for this award. I'm so honored to be recognized as an outstanding volunteer. I believe that God has a plan for each of us. His plan for me included attending the University of Houston, where I became a part of an athletic program with individuals who cared about the academic success of current and former student athletes. The support I received to complete my bachelor's degree changed the course of my life. So for me, it is important that I give back to a university that has been so instrumental in molding who I am today. I also want to thank the members of UH Cougars Athletic Alliance. As a member of this alumni group, I am able to work alongside former student athlete, alumni, and friends who are just as passionate as I am about the supporting the efforts of the University of Houston. Without the formation of this group, I would not be standing here tonight. Last but certainly not least, I would like to thank my family who is in the audience tonight, who support me no matter the endeavor. Thank you again, and I'm truly humbled by this award.
Thank you Sharon. Again, thank you very much. Before we move into our next category, I would like to have 2 of our past honorees stand, because we did not award in this category this year, but we want to recognize that they are here. From our Chair's Award category, past honoree Carolyn Farb is here. Where is Carolyn? Congratulations, Carolyn. Thank you very much. And from our Rising Star for Achievement, under 40, James Hong is here. Where is James? Hey. Okay, our Distinguished Service Award is up next, and I want to take a moment to have our past honorees in this category that are with us tonight please stand. And bear with me, this is quite a group. With us tonight, if you'll please rise, Murray Stinson, Sharon Stinson, Glenn and Judy Lilly, Kathy Coors Frank, Willie Burns, Tommy and Elaine Ebner, Judy Baxter, and Audrey McMillan. Please rise and receive our... Ladies and gentlemen, our past recipients for the Distinguished Service Award, thank you. Very rarely does the word service have any more meaning than it does tonight as we honor a gentleman who has consistently gone above and beyond the call on behalf of UHAA. We have a distinguished service honoree tonight who has demonstrated an ongoing willingness to participate and contribute to the well-being of UHAA and the University of Houston as a whole. We are very proud of our first honoree tonight.
I was born in 1941 in Louisiana, and we moved promptly to Port Arthur, Texas. Lived next door to Janis Joplin. It was an interesting 3 years. We moved to Houston in 1951. I think it was during one of the games. I jumped a magnificent jump of some 8 feet or something to get the ball, and they laughed at me and called me a grasshopper. But that name has stuck with me through high school, college, and up to now, and it's now shortened to Hopper. Unfortunately, that decade at least, my family broke up and had an effect on me and my sisters growing up without a father. Bless my mother, she somehow that got us through. So I did come to University of Houston, and I lived in the YMCA for $3 a night while I was going to school and taking a lab there, and also working at Vincent Elkins Law Firm 8 hours a day. So I got through and I got that degree in business, GBA. It's helped, it could help almost anyone in anything, and it has helped me. We were in an era then that the University of Texas and Texas A&M and maybe a couple of others have definitely looked down on the University of Houston scholastically. That has all changed to the better by hiring Dr. Renu Couture. The one thing I would say about my family, Link and Lacey and my little Pat, is that they knew that I enjoyed volunteering. My hobby is volunteering, and they allowed that. I never thought about doing things to be recognized. I've served on the Alumni Board of Directors for several years, which I thoroughly enjoyed, and working at the Livestock Show and the Houston Convention and Visitors Bureau, we get them involved with each other. The University of Houston with the Livestock Show, the University of Houston with the Convention Bureau. I wish we could do a little bit more of that. When I was told that I'd been selected to be a Distinguished Service Award, I was absolutely thrilled. It was my family that helped me get do these things, and I'm delighted that Link and Lacey are here tonight. I will say I'm very sorry that 3 years ago in March of 11, I lost my little Pat to Lou Gehrig's ALS disease, which sprung me right into being on the board of directors of the ALS state chapter. I volunteer my time for the University of Houston because the University of Houston has allowed me to do it. And it is an honor to be honored by the University of Houston for this honor.
Presenting Lance with his Distinguished Service Award tonight is past chair of the UH Board of Regents and a Distinguished Alumni Award honoree himself, Welkin Wilson Sr. Please welcome to the mic Lance Livingston.
Thank you, Mike. I need to thank a few people, of course, and one would be John Clark, who recommended me for this honor. Thank you, John. I'll tell you, there's so many people to thank. I've got some people in mind that would be floored if I did that. I have a host of people. My family is here tonight, and I'd like to recommend that you help me thank them. Link could not make it tonight. He just could not make it. We're both sick about that. But my daughter Lacey Dreese from Los Angeles is here. My beautiful sister Ann Lapresti from Katy, Texas is here. And my equally beautiful sister from Raleigh, North Carolina, Elaine Smith is here. Would you please help me thank them over there? I am very humbled, and I want to thank you again.
Thank you very much, Lance. I should know better, especially these two. I left two people off the list for distinguished service. And you know, this is good because someone who has given the better part of the last 65 years of their life to the University of Houston deserves a round of applause all to himself. Willie Burns, please stand up and get a round of applause. And a man who directs the spirit of Houston alumni group so ably for years before turning it over to Jennifer. Chris Mims, where are you? Chris Mims, I left you off the list as well. My apologies. Thank you, Lance. And this year we honor another great UH alum for his service, not only to his university, but pay close attention, obviously, to his state and to his country. Let me introduce to you Colonel Rick Noriega.
My father enlisted as a post-World War II enlistee out of the 2nd Ward in Houston, Texas, and was a paratrooper. We were a family of five and tried to live that TV-like lifestyle. Neither of my parents graduated high school, but they dedicated themselves to their children and to their education, and we were very fortunate to have had the parents that we had. I'm the second generation paratrooper, a person in the military. My enlistment into the military followed the Iranian hostage crisis. And then in the early 1980s, I was fortunate enough while attending my reserve duty weekends, was approached by Major Trochet. Major Trochet was with the University of Houston ROTC department and was looking for potential candidates. I saw this as an opportunity to complete my studies. I was very fortunate. The ROTC was the vehicle that allowed me to finish that dream. And then I was hired by then Houston Industries. So I got to work in corporate America as a part of a governmental relations team for a large utility company. I sought election in 1998 to the State House. So I began a tri-career, still as a citizen soldier, in the Texas Army National Guard as a Texas state representative, and then also still working for corporate America. Two things during my tenure that I would certainly point to as game-changing. One is, in 2001, I authored the Texas Dream Act. As a result of that passage of the Texas Dream Act, tens of thousands of students in the state of Texas have had the opportunity to attend universities. The second thing is that I was mobilized as a Texas Army National Guardsman to Afghanistan in 2004. I viewed that as that it was my turn in the queue. I had sworn that oath and commitment to duty a long, long time ago, and so it was my turn. It isn't about, me the people, it's about we the people. And if we aren't about that, then you should be living in another totalitarian country. But that is not America. As a product of this great university, I have a duty, a responsibility to change the course of where we're headed as a nation. I'm committed to creating more opportunities for the next generation so they can go on and do greater things than what we ever even imagined. The two takeaways for me as a graduate of the University of Houston was one, leadership, and two, communications. And I think both of those have worked hand in glove in anything that I've been able to achieve as an adult.
Presenting Rick with his Distinguished Service Award is a man who continues to distinguish himself in his service to University of Houston and his state, Senator John Whitmire. Ladies and gentlemen, Rick Noriega.
I was deferring to the Dean of the Senate if you wanted to say something before I did, but if you would please just focus your eyes here, because if you look at the screen, it adds 10 pounds to the picture. You know, and as a former politician, to say that I've got 2 or 3 minutes, that's almost impossible with this huge award. First, let me just say I was informed a little earlier, along with my other colleagues that are receiving awards tonight, that we're truly humbled to be in the same field with them, that Michael was somewhat of a last-minute throwdown for this particular task, and hasn't Michael done a great job and been a phenomenal leader for our university alumni? Secondly, I just want to do just a little moment of a point of privilege. And Ana Palacios, are you here, Ana? Somewhere? She leads this incredible team of people that are serving us this meal and this these drinks. And they, in fact, may be either U of H students in the hotel restaurant school, or their children may be in the future. So we want to thank them for serving us this wonderful meal tonight. I want to thank Dean Whitmire. I don't know if our school has ever enjoyed in the history of the state someone that graduated from our institution to be the Dean of the Texas Senate, especially at such critical times. He was my employer in 1993 when I first got my teeth kicked in a political race. He took me under his wing, and I owe a lot to John and his family for being such a friend and doing so much for us. So thank you, Dean, for being here with us tonight. I'm truly honored to receive this award for service. I recognize that I did not receive an award due to my educational excellence during my tenure at the university. During that 8-year tenure at the university. But, you know, we are a microcosm of what Ezekiel Cullen talked about, the vision of this institution, of it being the finest institution for the working men and women of the city of Houston. And so when my dad came home as a post-World War II veteran, he had a dream of becoming an electrical engineer, though he had not graduated from high school. And I still have a toolbox that he, given a couple of courses that he had taken, I still have that toolbox that he got as a part of that program. And I'm sorry that he is not able to be here with us tonight after having passed a couple of years ago. But I am proud that my mom is here to be able to be part of this. Tommy Noriega, who dedicated her life for so many years to, thank you, Mom, love you. And I also have my best friend, James Olson, and his wife, Kim, who are here because he and I, having gone through U of H, he said tonight to me tonight that he was unaware that the Alumni Association was so robust and that it was so vibrant. He always thought that between us doing tailgating, that, you know, and perhaps maybe getting arrested, that was the extent of our activity a lot with the University of Houston. And so it means a lot to me that my best friend's here. It means a lot to me that my in-laws are here, Dr. Charles and Connie Meisgeier, who spent 20 years in the School of Education as a professor. So thank you, Charles, for being here. And then it means a lot to me that my neighbor Betty McGinnis is here, who was with me during my tenure in the legislature. My son, who started out in the lab school at U of H and then went on into the charter school at U of H. I was telling my good friend Mark Cole Morgan and his wife Margaret, we used to travel a little bit together when I worked for that great supporter of our university, we were together on a trip. And my son, who's here with us tonight, was almost named Cancun, and he doesn't know why. My son Ricky's here with us. And the University of Houston young alumni was the reason that my wife, Melissa, and I are here 20-some-odd years later. And so we are truly humbled. You know, we
as part of this institution. It is part of our lives. It is part of who we are. It's our identity. It's shaped the values that were instilled in us as a part of public service and of trying to make in this world better. And we're just very, very humbled to be part of this great institution. Thank you so much for this award.
Thank you very much, Rick. All right, time now to make our way to the Distinguished Alumni category, and we have several honorees from the past here with us tonight. If the past honorees will please stand, they are Bill Sherrill, Welcome Wilson Sr., Senator John Whitmire, Gerald McKelvey, Cheryl Crusoe, Dorothy Nicholson, Robert Wohl is here tonight, Nick and Vicki Massad, and Richard Rawson. A round of applause for our former distinguished alumni who join us here this evening. The Distinguished Alumni Award is presented to a graduate or former student who brings honor and prestige upon the University of Houston. They are the best and brightest of what the University of Houston puts out year in and year out, Tier 1 alumni that give back in so many ways. As you know, UH has been labeled one of the most diverse universities in the country, and take a look at our honorees tonight. And it makes me proud to be a graduate to see our Cougars are doing well all around the world and the diverse impact in all the industries we are representing here tonight. Okay, enough of the lead up. This is an incredible group. It's time now to meet the pride of the pride. Ladies and gentlemen, our first honoree.
My family had just moved to Houston before I was born. So I grew up in Houston my whole life. I went to high school in Houston and started college at the University of Houston. Back at that point, my family didn't have a ton of money. The low tuition at the University of Houston was a big deal for me. When I was in law school, I was working my way through law school, whether it was summer work at Astroworld or sometimes working as a convenience store clerk at a 7-Eleven. I was doing what I could to scrape enough money together to manage my housing needs and pay for law school. The accessibility of a great public university like the University of Houston to someone like me, that just made a fundamental difference in the course of my life. So after I left the practice of law in Houston, I took this kind of step into the dark of trying to become a foreign policy expert. My law firm in Houston agreed to give me some work to do to help me pay my way through the next stage of school. And Christmas break in my first year going back to graduate school, I came back to Houston and sat second chair in a murder trial and used that money to help pay tuition bills. With the support of my new wife, who'd embarked on this strange journey with me, I became a career diplomat and then was detailed from my work in Washington as a career diplomat to go to work in the White House of the older President Bush, George H.W. Bush. It turned out that my colleague alongside me was a young woman from Stanford named Condi Rice, and we were at the center of the diplomacy to end the Cold War in Europe. I went back into government full time a couple of times, once to be the executive director of the 9/11 Commission. Then I later went back into government again, working with Condi as the counselor of the Department of State. I've also been an elected member of my town's school board. And believe me, if you've been in the halls of power in Washington, there's nothing more humbling or a healthier reminder of what real politics is like than to be a member of your town school board. Members in my town couldn't name who the members were in the cabinet in Washington, but boy, they sure knew who was on the school board, and they knew your phone number too. So after I left government, I was offered a teaching job at Harvard and kind of began a career as a scholar and as a historian, which I've continued as a professor and now dean at the University of Virginia. All these experiences in public service and in scholarship as a historian and dean have given me a lot of appreciation for different sides of American life, but I think the foundation for all of it was the education and preparation I received at the University of Houston.
A perfect example of what's going on in the world with University of Houston graduates presenting Dr. Philip Zelikow with his award tonight is Yusel Alonzo, UH alum and one of the nominators of Philip for this award. Ladies and gentlemen, a man who rarely accepts the spotlight, he deserves to receive a rightful round of applause. Please join me in congratulating Philip Zelikow. I'm going to introduce Yosel Alonzo, who has a special announcement he would like to read for Dr. Zelikow.
President Bush wanted to be the presenter tonight, but I am a very poor substitute for President Bush. Unsolicited, no one asking for this, I received this letter from President George Bush. Dear Philip, Barbara and I are checking in with our personal congratulations as the University of Houston Alumni Association pays tribute to you, the newest outstanding alumni. You have had an extraordinary career, and both my son, number 43, and I have been among the fortunate beneficiaries of your expertise and counsel. This prestigious recognition of your accomplishments and contributions is well deserved, and we Bushes join in saying, well done, Philip, very well done indeed. With warm best wishes, President George H.W. Bush. Fellow Cougs, the former executive director of the 9/11 Commission appointed by President George W. Bush, Dr. Philip David Zelikow.
Well, I'm very grateful to the University of Houston Alumni Association for this significant honor. All of you honor me. You honor public service by flattering me with this distinction. When I was a boy, I'd read about people who were big foreign policy advisors giving insight to the high and the mighty. I'd read about them in books. Sometimes you'd see them on TV. And I might have a childhood fantasy that maybe someday, maybe I could be one of those people. And maybe I'd also be a historian too, writing books people would read. I had no idea how I would ever become such thing, but I might fantasize about it. So here I am some years later, and I've gotten to do all those things. So my students now at Virginia, or my students before that at Harvard, these are all, of course, students who've been following master plans their whole lives and checking every box, come to see me, and basically they want to have a career like mine. And they say, how do we do this? Basically, what's the next box I need to check so that I can have the career you had? I can't tell them that actually you made a mistake. So you didn't go to the University of Houston. So back here among fellow Cougs, I can talk a little bit about just what the University of Houston did for me. I went to the University of Houston for the better part of 10 years off and on. I went 3 years as an undergraduate. I was didn't have a ton of money, didn't have very good grades in high school either. I was kind of a screw up in some ways. Probably none of you can identify with that at all. So I was interested in debate. I've been the beneficiary of probably one of the finest public school teachers who's ever been my privilege to meet in my life, a man named David Johnson from Bel Air High School, who's here tonight. And at the University of Houston, I joined a debate team, and I got a chance to compete at a national level with a powerhouse debate team. Some of my colleagues and partners there, a woman named Barbara Radnofsky, who would later run for the Senate in the state and get beat by Kay Hutchinson, but she's a nice lady anyway. Or Marvin Isger, who's sitting as a federal bankruptcy judge, or just a number of outstanding people, Gage Hunt, who's here tonight, and others. Competing at a national level in a debate program that was a national powerhouse at U of H. And by the way, that program languished for a number of years, and a couple of years ago, it was revived, in part with the leadership of Provost Paula Short, who I understand is here tonight, and partnering with the Honors College, which didn't exist in my day, and actually is again competing nationally as a powerhouse, inspiring young people to think that they can play on the biggest stages, the way it inspired me. I was inspired by history professors like Stanley Siegel, like James Kirby Martin, who's here tonight, Cliff Egan, Hannah Decker, others. These people kind of put me in the shoes of some of those leaders I'd read about in the books and got me thinking about them some more. But of course, I didn't know how to get any of those jobs, so I went to law school. And I came, after I left U of H for a year and got my degree from another school, I came back to U of H for law school, got my law degree at U of H, did okay, clerked for the Court of Criminal Appeals, came back to Houston to practice, and while I was practicing law in Houston, felt an itch to work on more things just besides the law, though the law was wonderful, and went back to U of H again, taking graduate courses and odd hours. Of course, it was U of H is the kind of school that had a place for people like that. And that inspired me to go back to graduate school and try to find a way to work in foreign affairs. And that worked out. And I've kind of gotten to do all the things that I dreamed about in high school through a career path no one could have charted. Not because I was always the straight A student, I wasn't, but because the University of Houston gave me the foundation, and it gave me a chance. So let me talk, thank you. Because U of H is actually a school that's not at all like a school like Harvard or Virginia, where I've spent my teaching career. Those are places you enter them, the ivy-covered halls, the lawn, the greensward, and you think, you're in a different place. You're in kind of some sort of classical paradise. But you know what? The real world is not a classical paradise. And those places aren't like the real world. The University of Houston is a lot like the real world. The University of Houston is actually a lot like the city of Houston. It's big. It's scrappy. And it's wide open to give people chances. And so where I want to end up is by thanking all of you for being here tonight and supporting the university, because this is where you can make a difference. I'll tell you something. When I think about the future of America is not going to be determined by how well Harvard does or how well Virginia does. Those are great schools. They really are. And you know what? They're going to do fine. They're going to do fine. And when you try to chart out how America's future is going to look, the index is not going to be, is Harvard succeeding? The index is going to be, are schools like the University of Houston succeeding? Because if they succeed, places like the city of Houston and this country succeed. And if they fail, so goes the country. So you're being here tonight, and your support for this university, you're putting your finger on the variable that's going to make a difference, the biggest difference, for this city and for this country. And for that, I thank you.
Okay, I looked at the program before tonight, and was I ever looking forward to meeting our next honoree, Rafael Ortega?
I was born in West Laco, Texas. My parents moved the family to Houston when I was about 3 and a half. There's a total of 6 of us in the family. I have 2 sisters and 3 other brothers. We didn't have much. We did with the bare necessities. I remember during the summer we were able to get in our bikes and ride around the neighborhood, you know, just to stay out of the house, because if we went back into the house, my mother made us do chores. My dad was self-employed. He was a drywall subcontractor. And my mother just did a number of things. One of her longest stints was working up at the airport. My father went to fifth grade and was never able to complete because his father passed away, and so he ended up having to work. My mother really did not have any formal schooling to speak of. They knew what I had. They knew I had talent. You know, I have to tell you this, and I'm sorry, I can't keep it straight. You know, I actually thought my parents were more strict on me than they were on my siblings, because they knew what I could do. Whenever I had major assignments, projects,
I got a free ride from doing some of the house chores. All I had to do was tell them, is, look, I got this project. You know, they find one of my brothers or sisters to do my chore because they put school first. I went to the University of Houston because that was the place where I could keep a job and go to school at the same time. Even though I had a scholarship, the Houston Endowment Scholarship, I still had to work. So I was working anywhere from 30 to 35 hours a week. When I got into my engineering classes, I actually joined up to the student chapter of ASCE. And that really proved to be the most valuable organization that I was a member of on campus, you know, because we had the old Y building. And for any engineering student of years past would recognize that only last year was the Y building ever tore down. And it was a study hall. And it was very valuable to me, especially getting support on some of the assignments, each of us helping each other out. It just, quite frankly, even provided a couch for you to take a nap between classes. When I first started working at Lockwood Anders and Newnham, I was a low man on the totem pole. But within the first 3 months, I realized that the training that I had received in managing people, developing, you know, schedules, most engineers that I was assigned to work with either didn't want to do it, didn't have an understanding, and it was foreign to them. And literally within the first 6 months, I was doing schedules, I was doing workload projections for folks who had been working in engineering for 8 to 10 years. If you look, whether it's the highway department, whether you look at the city of Houston, you look at any of the governmental agencies around this region, you have U of H engineering graduates that are now either in charge or definitely up at the top of the organization. I think the Engineering Alumni Association was key to continuing to build this momentum that I think the U of H engineers now have in the Houston area. The University of Houston affords an individual a fantastic opportunity, especially if you want to be an engineer.
Presenting Raphael with his award tonight is Dennis Peterson, president of Lockwood, Andrews, and Newnham. Ladies and gentlemen, Rafael Ortega.
Well, I have 25 pages of notes, but I think I'll just stick to 4 pages here. First of all, I really want to recognize the other distinguished alumnus and honorees tonight for their outstanding achievements and the impact that they have made to the community. Because of these achievements, the University of Houston has risen to a prominent stature. U of H is a Tier 1 university because so many people like these honorees have done what they've done. And I'm humbled to be counted among them and their notable achievements. You know, I really wish I could personally thank all the individuals that God has placed in front of me or in my life to encourage me and who were an inspiration along the way. You know, when you're in engineering school and you're pulling in an all-nighter, you get tired. And there are times I actually wanted to quit. But these individuals in my life somehow had the right word at the right time, and they knew what to say to keep me going. Among these special people, my parents, my brothers and sisters, my teachers, my professors, like Dr. O'Neill, Dr. Ghazali, friends, ministers, co-workers, professional associates, and at times even a stranger who could say the right word at the right time. But what was important is that they looked beyond what I was and they saw what I could be. Tonight's recognition is part theirs. For without their influence in my life, I could not be here. I also want to thank my daughter, Sarah, and my sons, Austin and Andy, for understanding and supporting me when I've had to work those late nights, even bringing home work on a weekend, and even tolerating my constant work mindset. No, I'm not a workaholic. I just have a constant work mindset. You know, when I was first notified that I had been selected for this award, my response to Mike was, are you sure you're talking to the right guy? It took me a long while to realize that it wasn't a prank call, that he actually was talking to me. And in the days leading after that,
I had to continue asking myself why, you know, why me? And I've concluded that there were two main drivers in my life, which I refer to as principles that I'd like to share with you. The first, it's the little things in life that matter, that truly define a person. You know, we all can't walk on the moon. We all can't find a cure for some debilitating disease. Quite frankly, we can't all be governor or a senator. But each of us can help build a better life for those around us, one brick at a time, one life at a time. Each of us can influence a young man or a woman who's still trying to find their direction in life, one life at a time. I stand before you a testament, a living testament, of how others have impacted my life. It's the little things in life that really matter. Whether it's saying a kind word to a cashier whom you notice has had a rough day, remembering to pray for our troops in harm's way, or even attending a U of H sporting event showing your Cougar pride. In doing so, we're giving back to the community and we're impacting the lives of others that come after us. The second principle is that your weakness can be your strength. If you've ever been around a person who's lost their sight, you'll note that they have developed some keen senses much greater than what you and I might have. You know, over the years, I've had the privilege of working with two individuals who were legally blind, Calvin Curtis and Diane Whitney. Both of them used what you and I would call a perceived handicap, weakness, to their advantage. They never made an excuse for their sight. Calvin's legal acumen, his memory, his recall are phenomenal. The years I had a chance to work with him on a project for the city of Houston, he was just an inspiration to me every time I got around him. He's one of the best attorneys I've ever worked with. And quite frankly, I'd put his mind up to any attorney that I know of. And then there's Diane. Diane, who was my administrative assistant for a number of years until she married one of my coworkers, and then she decided to stay at home and be a mom. But she taught me the true meaning of life in the sense of being appreciative, recognizing the little things. Her work ethic and sincerity could not be overlooked. But both Calvin and Diane were examples of leveraging a weakness into a strength. What matters is whether we make excuses for these perceived weaknesses, or in the case of Calvin and Diane, where they leveraged those weaknesses into a strength. For these weaknesses truly are a blessing from God when we recognize them as such. Thank you, U of H alumni, for recognizing me for this award. God bless each of you, and go Cougs.
Thank you, Raphael. Congratulations, Tom.
Thank you, Raphael. We have two introverts left. Let's take a look at our next honoree and welcome into a pretty exclusive club, although he's already in one pretty exclusive club.
My mother raised me when I was from the age of six and beyond, and it takes kind of a family effort to raise a young man. And my mother, she was certainly the benchmark for that, but my grandparents were right in the center of my life throughout. And my grandmother, I can remember spending many, many Saturdays and many, many afternoons on some pond somewhere fishing with her and learning life lessons. She became my best friend who I would go to even later years in my life. to lean on her, you know, for difficult situations, and she passed away 15 years ago. Mom, she didn't want me to play. I was her only child, and she thought that I'd end up hurt in some way, shape, or form. And she actually missed the sign-up date on purpose 2 years in a row. to sign up to play Little League football. I didn't always want to be a football player, and I knew through college that I could go on to be whatever I wanted, but the goal all of those years was to grow up and provide myself with the opportunity to play college football and provide myself with an education through college football. By the time I'd got to campus, there was a coaching change. Coach Yeoman had stepped aside, and then Coach Pardee was hired, and there couldn't have been two totally different offenses in terms of the veer, going from the veer to the run and shoot. You know, it was Coach Pardee who gave me the opportunity to step under center and lead his football team. And you know, there wasn't a time that I could go to Coach Pardee that his door wasn't open. He was always receptive. He taught you, you know, how to represent a program, how to make people proud of you, how to be accountable for your action. And those were tremendous life lessons that you continue to live by to this day. And I can say that I'm proud to be the first African-American quarterback to win the award. It had never happened to that point in time, and wanted our entire football team to share in the moment if it was going to happen. So that day at Rice got into place in a small dressing room that they kind of provided for us via satellite back to New York, and we crowded as many offensive linemen and guys that had contributed that season into that room as we possibly could. Along with Coach Pardee, and the announcement was made, and we were all just totally surprised and overcome with emotion, because this was our bowl game, and this was the attention that we so badly wanted for our football program, and we wanted to go out and play the best and beat the best, and most Saturdays we did that. What I'm doing now, you know, doing games on radio for the Texans, which is kind of how I cut my teeth at the University of Houston. I'm the type of person, I want to work for it. I want to, you know, climb the ladder, so to speak. So I started putting the reps in, did radio there, and it's kind of turned itself into a TV career where I'm calling games on ESPN each and every Saturday afternoon, and then Sundays scurrying through most airports here throughout the country to get to wherever the Texans are the next day and be able to call games. It's special. You know, when you look and you fast forward to where I am today and what I do today, I owe to the University of Houston for just providing the opportunity and the platform to develop not only athletically, but grew into a man and matured and just an opportunity to live out his dreams.
Please welcome Andre Ware to the stage. Presenting Andre with his Distinguished Alumni Award is Stephen Holmes, longtime friend of Andre's and Galveston County Commissioner. Ladies and gentlemen, the 1989 Heisman Trophy winner and my good friend Andre Ware.
Thank you very much. I got one question for everybody in the room. Whose house?
Whose house?
Whose house?
Whose house?
How about that? We can get this thing going. We can make a Cougs house anywhere. That's what we usually do. Rick, I'm in agreement with you on that 10 pounds thing. We call it the TV 10. You know, that happens every once in a while, so I agree with Rick. Stick this way. How about a round of applause for Mike Padey, my good friend. He's done a heck of a job tonight, and all of us say that we love the university, but Mike carries it close to his heart. He is passionate about the school, and I don't know that there's anybody that loves it as much as that man. I'm gonna try not to take too much time tonight because I know it's been a long evening. A lot of people are ready to go home, get tucked in. I've got a little one over there that should have long been tucked in, but he's going full speed right now. I'm trained to go 3.5 hours plus overtime, but I won't bore you with that tonight. Stephen Holmes, who's my presenter, how about a hand for him? He is a Rice graduate among all of these Cougars. And proud to call him my friend and a guy that I looked up to in high school. Really kind of took me under his wing and through him and his family, his older brother Dwayne, really kind of taught me the rights and wrongs and how to go about doing things and doing them certainly in the proper way. My family is seated over at table 6. My mother's here, who has been along every journey that I've embarked on. My better half, Mary Ann, and our little one, Zaylin is here tonight. My mother, Limai Borda, and Peepaw, Uncle Ray's here tonight with me, and so that's my support group, and I really thank them because they allow me to travel the country during the falls and go from, as I mentioned in the video, one airport to another to do what I love to do while they help to take care of my little three-year-old. It's always good to come back and you see family and you see friends and those that were at the University of Houston long before you, those that were there during your time period, and certainly the newer Cougars that take care of the university while we've moved on. Audrey McMillan and James Holmes, you know, it's kind of funny. They're older guys who I consider friends and call friends. And we just kind of recognize one another as Coug. And we'll see each other, whether it's at a golf course or in a grocery store, and it's, what's up, Coug? And it's just the bond that we have, having gone to the same university, worn the same colors, and still carrying that bond to this day. So it's good to see Audrey and James here tonight as well. You know, when you're a high school recruit, you think you're a hot shot, you can be humbled pretty quickly. And being recruited out of high school, I had a lot of offers, but not a lot of them that would allow me to step under center and continue to do what I did in high school and as a young pup growing up playing the game of football. But when Bill Yeoman sits in your living room and says that he wants you to come to school and he's going to give you an opportunity to play quarterback, well, it was a simple decision at that point. The university allowed me to live a dream to go to college, which I knew that if I got there, I'd be dang if I wasn't gonna leave without a degree, because I knew that was a pretty good head start on life. So that was my motivation for attending the University of Houston, or just wanting to go to college and play college football. Everything else beyond that has been kind of a bonus. And then you start to shift from one career to the next. And then once again, right there, waiting for me to help me take the next step from professional football into a new career was the University of Houston. And I say that because that's where I cut my teeth, Cougar Radio. Came back, Chet Gladchuk was the athletic director and gave me the opportunity to call games on radio. And it's morphed itself into something pretty special now that I can't say I've worked a day in my life, to be quite honest, because if you truly love what you're doing, it really doesn't feel like work. And each and every fall, each and every week leading up to a Saturday, most off seasons as I prepare for shows on College Football Live, it really is kind of a dream come true and a continuation of what you want to do. It keeps you just close enough to the game, but without actually being hit. You know, my high school coach, Dub Ferris, who is not in attendance tonight, he's in a commitment in San Antonio, really became the father figure in my life. And he told me a long time ago the definition of character. He says, it's not when you're flying high and you're celebrating. It's how you're going to react when things happen and you get knocked down. And I've had my share of that. I had it at the University of Houston my freshman year when I broke my arm. I've had it along the way, and it's how you respond and you get up and you continue the fight. I learned that that valuable lesson right on the campus on Cullen, how to get up, how to fight, how to persevere, and make a comeback. Congratulations to all the other honorees. This is a heck of a class, and I got a chance to meet just about each and everybody backstage, and you see why they're unique in their different fields and how they stand out and make this university proud. I just want to say thank you. Thank you for providing the platform for me to live out a dream each and every day. Go Cougs.
So we have a little mini surprise, and he doesn't know I'm going to do this. So Coach Levine, will you join me real quick? Can I get Coach Levine to hop up here? So we have a little surprise for Andre. Tony Levine, ladies and gentlemen. You recognize him. He cleans up real nice.
Who didn't know you were going to do this, me or Andre?
I didn't know you were going to do, I didn't know I was going to do it, so hang in there. So play, we're going to have a little special announcement, and this wouldn't happen without the coordination between the Alumni Association and the head football coach in athletics, Hunter Yurchek's over there. He's our newest senior associate AD over there, or AVP. Hunter, thank you. Welcome to campus. As many of you know, we've worked hand-in-hand the last few years to have alternate jerseys, including last year's black jersey. Well, we have a special announcement to make. We are unveiling tonight that, working with Coach Levine, next year we will be wearing 1989 throwback jerseys in honor of Andre Ware on homecoming. You will see it spin here in a minute. And as you know, we will normally have those for auction. So Andre, congratulations. We're looking forward to it. That doesn't happen without the great work in athletics, so thank you all very, very much. And yes, the helmet will match 1989, so everybody asked me that question. Yes. So we're really looking forward to that. Well, we unveiled that little surprise, and that brings us to our last honoree this evening. After reading all the bios of our honorees tonight and knowing this gentleman the last couple of years, our next honoree sure brings a lot to the table.
Well, I grew up in Dallas, Texas, big family, 8 kids. Unfortunately, my father died when I was 7, so my mom became a rock star. My mom was one of those people that when you met her, you felt like you were the only person she met that day. But then she actually ended up managing a grocery store deli. So funny that I would later get into the restaurant business, but I learned more about people in business my mom than anyone. Well, I started working at 13, Youngblood's Fried Chicken. They needed a summer busboy and dishwasher. And I found out right then that I loved the restaurant business. Well, I graduated from high school in Dallas, and I knew that we didn't have the money to pay any out-of-state tuition, and Houston had that $150 a semester. That's all it cost. That intrigued me. 4 hours down Interstate 45, I was a Cougar in 1970. Well, during my time in the dorms, social really became athletics. I loved playing intramural sports, and so I got hooked up with this famous group called the OB Gangbangers. They were legendary in their sports prowess, but had just a tremendous time playing sports and getting to know people in both dorms. But probably even more important was my work experience. Being a student advisor was amazing. That first year on the 9th floor of Moody Towers, I had all these freshmen. For some reason, the floor named ourselves the Geekers. And if you remember, streaking was a very popular sport going around in the 70s. And so one night, all the freshmen came to my room and said, "Hey Doug, we're going out streaking. We'll be the Geeker Streakers. And you'll be proud of me." I didn't go with them, although I didn't stop them, and they went around the campus on like a Friday night, geeker streaking, and then came back to the floor, and I told them to get in their rooms and put their clothes on, and no one knows that I knew they were going to participate in that, thank goodness. So while I was still a student advisor, you weren't supposed to have another job, but Chris Fowler, who was my advisor my first year as a freshman, later became head of the dorm. He allowed me a couple nights a week to bartend at this amazing restaurant in Southwest Houston called the Great Mind Company. And I became a manager there when I graduated. So 22 years old, underqualified, I'm running one of the top steakhouses in the city of Houston. But the owner there liked to take advantage of naive young college students who would work 90 hours a week for no pay, and I was perfect for the job. But I met my wife, Holly, there. We've been married almost 37 years, so that became not an important career job, but also an important family relationship. My best friend Ken Dennis was there, who was also part of the hotel school, and that became the trigger to interviewing with Chili's. And 5 years later, the greatest leader in the history of the restaurant industry, Norman Brinker, joined us. The company went public, became Brinker International, became one of the largest casual dining portfolio companies in the world, a Fortune 500 company, and somehow 14 jobs later, I became the president and CEO and chairman of the board of this amazing company. Well, Norman Brinker used to say it's nice to be important, but more important to be nice. It's fantastic being part of Eric's Club. So Eric's Club is the alumni group of the Hilton Restaurant and Hotel School. And we get to come back twice a year and meet the students. Now you realize that a busboy can become the CEO of a billion-dollar company. That isn't just my story. I want to help other kids see the opportunities that I had and the potential successes they could have in this wonderful hospitality industry. Well, to be part of this event tonight, it's an incredible honor, again, because of what I learned while I was at the University of Houston. So I'm proud to get the honor, and I'll try to do everything I can to live up to what this honor means.
Presenting the 2014 Distinguished Alumni Award to Doug Brooks is Don Smith, former UH faculty member and a man who certainly had an impact on Doug's life. Thank you, Don. Ladies and gentlemen, Doug Brooks.
Well, thank you. Thank you to the University of Houston Alumni Association, obviously to our president, CEO, and MC, Mike Padet. Also, Allie Walker, who behind the scenes organized this wonderful evening. Give it up for Allie. Also, Brad Yu and his talented team who put together all the videos, and everyone involved in tonight's program. When I think of the total number of graduates of this great university and the small number of recipients of this honor, and after listening to the other honorees, it is incredibly humbling to be up here this evening. I do have lots of thank yous for those that reported my Cougar experience. Mike and Connie Knight, who are here this evening. Mike and I came to the University of Houston from high school together. We had some great Moody Tower experiences, and Mike has had a fantastic architectural career after getting his degree here. Many of my fellow OB gangbangers and dorm buddies are here. And their impact and friendship I'll never forget. The late, great Mark Kuhlman, Dr. K, his red afro, his athletic skills, and his years working in the intramural department won't be forgotten soon. Also, Sam and Lou and Barbara and Dale and Nick and Ben and Fleetwood and Satch and Buster and Mike and Chris Fowler and Bobby and Ronnie Brownstein and Lobster Man Joe Pfeiffer and Far Out Flanagan and Bob Cowan and of course, the man who was honored 2 years ago, Robert Wool, a.k.a. LaFong. Who'd ever thunk that two OB gangbangers would be described as distinguished alums? Our dream in the 1970s was to be called distinguished customers of Frenchie's Chicken on Scott Street. You better believe it. You better believe it. The gangbangers did have an amazing run in intramural those days, including when we actually became a fraternity. We created a fraternity called Omicron Beta. 3 years undefeated in softball, all school championships. Dominance in flag football, including one all school championship, running the wishbone offense. Eat your heart out, Andre and David over there. We had the historic romp of Sigma Chi and Hoffman's Pavilion before a real Cougar game. There were some great times. Yeah, sorry. Beating any fraternity Cliff Halfen was a part of was worth it. That was the best part. From a family perspective, my older brother Lewis and his wife Marcia are here tonight. In fact, Marcia had a double knee replacement surgery 4 weeks ago in Dallas, and she drove down I-45 to be here this evening. Yes. Louie may have beat me up when I was young, but he's now the greatest big brother you could ever wish for, and he mostly just beats me in golf now. My sister Stephanie is here. When my father died and my mom was working, Steph got a raw deal because she had to be kind of a babysitter and a sub-mom, having to take care of a bunch of irresponsible brothers. We appreciate you, Stephanie. You were forced to grow up way too fast. Thank you, babe. My two sons, Taylor and Kyle, are here tonight. Great kids who put up with an executive who traveled too much, worked too many nights and too many weekends. But now that they're 32 and 27, it feels like we're friends instead of fathers and son, and I'm very proud of the men they've grown up to become. Thank you, Taylor and Kyle. And my wife of almost 37 years, Holly. She's a Red Raider, but we'll let it slide. She's always been my rock, supporting my crazy restaurant career and standing beside me when I had a life-threatening and life-changing injury 16 years ago. Being my wife has been a tough job, and she's been really, really good at it. Love you, babe. And the Hilton School of Hotel and Restaurant Management has had a great impact on me. So Coach Don Smith, this teacher who had an incredible influence on so many young hospitality students, and he still does today, because Coach Smith taught us about life as well as the hospitality industry. And now he's in his 80s, and he's still teaching many of us about how to live. It is pretty cool for me to send emails back and forth today to a teacher and a man who was bigger than life to me when I was a teenager in my 20s. Thank you, Coach. Thanks also to the Eric Club members and the Hilton School faculty are here tonight. We have three previous HRM grads that I'm aware of that have had this distinguished honor: Patty Godfrey, Dorothy Nicholson, and Nick and Vicki Massett. I hope the rest of you realize how highly regarded the Hilton School of Restaurant and Hotel Management is around the U.S. and the world. It is on a very, very short list when people name the top programs, and we're either at the top, in my opinion, or very high on that list. Retiring Dean John Bowen has done a fabulous job in his 11 years as dean, taking to our program to new heights, and we're indebted to him for his vision and his leadership. Thank you, Dean Bowen. Also, great relationship with Assistant Dean of Development John Schultz, Professor Emeritus Clinton Rapole, and so many others doing a fantastic job preparing young hospitality students for the real world. It is a great time, as we've talked about tonight, to be at the University of Houston under amazing President Couture's leadership. I heard this story, I don't know from who, and I don't know how accurate it is, but I was told that at President Couture's first meeting of the Board of Trustees, she looked down the table and said, anyone in this room that doesn't want to compete against University of Texas and Texas A&M, you can walk out now because you're wasting my time. And she's been kicking butt and taking names ever since. And so for a kid that had 4 years living in the residence hall and had an incredible on-campus experience, I always hated it when this university was called a commuter school. So to know that there are now 8,000 on-campus rooms, the second most of any college in the state of Texas, is warm to my soul and heart. It's awesome. So we've got Tier 1 status, $1 billion of construction, the new on-campus football stadium, the new University Center. University of Houston has never been hotter for graduates, for all of us, and I've never been prouder. And so I'll close talking about the opportunities and responsibilities I had as a student in the dorms that prepared me for the job leading Brinker International. Because I took all those jobs that nobody wanted. I was the morning cashier at OB Hall, arriving every morning at 5:30 a.m. Then I became the student manager at OB Hall, arriving at 5 a.m., unlocking the doors for the kitchen staff and supervising them. I was then the student manager of the Red Barn Snack Bar in the basement of the Moody Towers. I was then the student manager for the Sunday night dinner for the athletes in the Moody Towers. I learned a lot doing that. And finally, 2 years as a student advisor in the Towers. So being in charge of 40 freshmen for a year prepares you for everything possible in later life. So those jobs gave me an opportunity learning about managing and leading people that helped me later lead that global portfolio Fortune 500 restaurant company that had 2,000 restaurants in 50 states, 30 countries, employed over 120,000 team members, and served 400 million guests a year. It was quite a ride, but it was because of the experience I had working on campus in the Moody Towers, in the Hobie Hall, working for ARA, now Aramark, at the University of Houston. So thanks to all of you, thanks to the university for this incredible honor, and go Cougs.
This can't be good.
Special announcement. This is for Doug, a special announcement again. In honor of Doug's alumni award, Chili's is going to have 1989 throwback ribs. They've been marinating. It's about time. They've been sticking in the storehouse with them. I just want to say how proud I am of my old good buddy here and two of us, huh? How about that? It's family. Your dad done good. Take care.
We came out of that a lot better than I thought we would, actually. Well, I have nothing to say after that, except the final agenda tonight will be to sing our alma mater. But before we leave, I want you to, when you're walking out, look at the screens to see if you're the lucky winner in our auction tonight. I want to thank everyone. There's a lot of you who donated auction items here in the room, and all of you who are auction winners tonight, thank you so much. Also, please take a look at your program. If you have the sticker on the back of your program, you get to take the centerpiece home. And if you check the big boards on the way out tonight, see if your name appears. And if it does, we thank you. I ask that you please rise. Please, I knew that. We'd lose you. Please rise and join me in the singing of the University of Houston alma mater, which at its conclusion, we will be adjourned. It has truly been an honor to join you tonight, spend some time with the Cougars, feel the wave of enthusiasm rushing over. And ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for supporting the University of Houston.